Good morning, everyone. Myself, Dr. Sarita Bang, and today we will be doing the sonnet by John Milton, On His Blindness. John Milton was born in 1608 and died in 1674, poet and pamphleteer in London. Educated at Cambridge, he was well trained in classical languages. His early poetry was in Latin. The Civil War pushed him into political life through pamphleteering after the Restoration in 1660. Milton was out of favor because of his pro-Cromwellian attitude. It was only the intervention of influential friends which protected him from political persecution. There is uncertainty about the date of the composition of this sonnet. It could have been written any time between 1642 to 1651 or even later, but was first published in 1673. Let me read the sonnet out for you before explaining it. When I consider how my life is spent, year, half my days in this dark world and wide, and that one talent which death is to hide, lodged with me useless, though my soul more bent to serve therewith my Maker and present my true account, lest he returning chide, doth God exact day labor that light denied? I fondly ask, but patience to prevent, that murmur soon replies, God doth not need either man's work or his own gifts. Who best bear his mild yoke, they serve him best. His state is kingly, thousands at his bidding speed, and post over land and ocean without rest, they also serve who only stand and wait. In the first line, the poet considers how his light is used up or wasted, the light of his eyesight. Is wasted or put forth in the world in a poem on blindness. Light can most easily be interpreted as his ability to see, but for this deeply religious poet, it may also mean an inner light or spiritual capacity. In line two, the poet assumes that his life is not yet half over. The phrase, in this dark world and wide, is typical of one of the ways Milton handles adjectives, putting one in front of the noun and one behind it. In the third line, the poet may refer to the biblical parable of the talents, Matthew chapter 4, verse 14 to 30, which speaks of a bad servant who neglects his master's talent. A talent was a kind of coin in those days. Instead of using it, he is cast into outer darkness. It can also mean a literal talent. In other words, Milton's talent as a writer. Lodged with me useless, lines 4 to 6. Lodged with me useless means that his talent as a poet is useless now that he is losing his sight. Though my soul more bent to serve therewith my Maker can be roughly paraphrased, although my soul is even more inclined to serve God with that talent. This is especially frustrating, to want to serve God with his writing, but to feel his talent will be wasted as he becomes blind. He wishes ultimately to present his true account or give a good account of himself and his service to God. In the fifth line, he expresses the speaker's desire to serve God through his poetry, to use his talents for the glory of God. In the sixth line, this line may refer to the second coming of Christ or to the judgment, lest he returning chide. Chide means scold. When we return after death and face the last judgment, God would chide us, can be paraphrased, so he won't chide or rebuke or scold me when he returns. 7th and 8th line, Milton grumblingly asks here if God just wants day work or smaller, lesser tasks, since Milton's blindness denies him his light and thus the use of his talents. Note that Milton allows his grumbling tone to show first, then qualifies his own attitude as foolish, fondly. Fondly means foolishly. Line 8, patience is not capitalized but has often been thought of as a personification here rather than as another aspect of Milton's inner self. Either way, in the inner dialogue, patience speaks in the remaining 6 lines quite effectively, having the last word. In the 9th line, patience speaks to prevent that murmur, Milton's questioning of God's will in line 7. Patience's reply, that is patience personified, reply explains one aspect of the nature of God and affirms a kind of service to God that is different from the service advocated in the parable of the talents in the Bible. First of all, God does not need man's work or God-given talents. The nature of service to God is explained next. Who best bear his mild yoke means the people who are most obedient to God's will, which is mild, not difficult. These people are the ones who serve God best. The image of the yoke is also biblical. A yoke was a kind of harness put on oxen, but in Matthew chapter 11, verse 29 to 30, it is an image of God's will. His state is kingly, explains God's greatness. Patience goes on to elaborate in the next lines that greatness. Lines 12 and 13. At God's bidding or will, thousands of people and by implication angelic messengers speed and post, run fast up and down all over the world all the time. This line implies a sort of constant worldwide motion of the service to God's commands. That allows the last line to imply, by contrast, a great restfulness and peace. There is more than one way to serve God, and patience is telling the poet that even his waiting for the apparent inaction caused by his blindness can be a kind of service if it meets the criterion of line 10 and 11 to bear the yoke well. This line, "They also serve who stand and wait," is a very famous line and is often quoted, and the whole poem, the whole sonnet, shows the frustration of the author, the poet, when he starts losing his eyesight before he has passed his prime. But later on, patience, which is personified in the poem, asks him to stand, just wait and serve God, and everything would be all right. Thank you.